Thank you so much for still joining us to stay in tune to independent television here in Benin City. And happy Workers' Day one more time, just like what we've been saying here since we started this program, that today is Workers' Day. We are celebrating the Nigerian worker as the whole world is celebrating the average worker. So most nations of the world on this day, this first day of May 2019, are really, really celebrating workers across the globe. Well, today we are so privileged to have two gentlemen here, so we're going to be doing justice to some issues that we're going to be raising here today, talking about labor unionism, labor movements, the struggle so far, and the cardinal objectives, you know, that has really brought labor movement to bear in Nigeria. And just like what I said at my opening, the issue of unionism really came to bear sometime in 1888 in the United States of America, where some employers exploited employees to work for more than 8 hours. Of course, it had to come to the extent that those employees had to say that no, it is enough. And of course, that was what gave rise to the struggle of 8 hours at work, 8 hours for leisure, 8 hours for rest, and of course, 8 hours for sleep. So as an employee there, if you work for more than 8 hours, it shows that you are being exploited, because the international labor law states that no employee is supposed to work for more than 8 hours. Well, that is just on the side. Here in Nigeria, at about 1978, when the NSA came on board, we are told that four affiliate bodies, namely the Nigeria Labour Trade Union Congress, and of course we also had the Labour Unity Front, United Labour Congress, and the Nigeria Workers Council. These were the four major affiliate bodies that the NSA started with. And of course, over the years from 1978 to about dates, it's about 40 something years. Affiliate bodies of the NSA has grown to about 45, 49 affiliate bodies of the NLC. All these bodies, you know, group together, they struggle, they fight for labor. And very recently we saw the fight that labor had to go through with the government in trying to bring the minimum wage to bear of 30,000 naira. Well, to discuss all this morning, we are so privileged to have two gentlemen here. Mr. Neville Obakedo is a political analyst and also a public affairs analyst. Sir, you're welcome to this morning on ITV.
Thank you for
also,
having me.
And also a lecturer at the University of Benin, to precise, Department of Political Science and Public Administration. Sir, you're welcome one more time.
Thank you for having me, sir.
Yeah, my big brother friend is also here, Money Mike Modesty Itua, the former secretary of NLC Edo State and former secretary of former treasurer of NSC Edo State, and a lifetime labor devotee. Sir, welcome to this program. It's put on ITV.
Good morning.
Yeah.
Happy Workers' Day.
All right. So, Money Mike Modesty, we are celebrating you this morning. So, happy Workers' Day. Congratulations.
Thank you so much.
Yeah. All right. Just like what I said, down the memory lane, for about 41 years now, the struggle has been on of the NLC, that's the Nigeria Labor Congress. What will you say, has been the cardinal objectives of labor movements in Nigeria?
Well, since the establishment, the formal establishment of the Nigeria Labor Congress in 1978, judging by the history you have read out, which amounted to some central bodies coming to form one united body, which is the NLC.
Yeah.
You will know that even historically, when you make references to the United States, how people were being exploited and how the struggle eventually came to Nigeria, the wars and all the fights that people like Michael Imodu and his contemporaries had to fight, which eventually dovetailed into the 1978 establishment of the NLC. You will agree with me wholeheartedly that the struggle by organized labor, let me not be using the word organized labor, because the Trade Union Congress is also existing as a labor center through the law of 2005. The organized labor in Nigeria have really fared very well in many aspects. Usually you hardly have anything called opposition. During the military era, I think that was where the heat was really so much, because military intervention into our polity and others, and having to contend with the forces of the military juntas that had to force all Nigerians to eat granite, and the labor was there to a great extent. You remember the June 12th imbroglio, political imbroglio. You remember the Kokoris and all of them. And eventually how ASU and many other unions were conscripted and made to be banned by one way or the other by some military junta. A lot of issues historically that have happened all over the years. Then let us not forget in a hurry that economically speaking, as far as our national economy is concerned, we constitute about 98% of those that turn the engine of the economy. I'm telling you this because the economy cannot even exist. You can't even talk of an economy without the worker. Mm. It is the worker that creates the wealth of any nation. So, but we are also saying that we have been creating this wealth. And to a great extent, the wealth has not showed so much on us. Whether you're in the public or in the private sector, it has really not shown so much on us. Fundamentally, too, you would not ask the question, why that? If we want to espouse on all the issues, the time may not even be there for us. Because most of the troubles bedeviling us as a nation, whether it is economic or just mention it, they are all imposed on us by bad leadership. And if you critically examine it, whether it was during the military era or during the democratic era, we can also not exempt ourselves as workers. Mm-hmm. Because in one way or the other, we have been involved. So I am not the kind of person who would want to always point accusing fingers, forgetting that the other ones
pointing at you.
If, for instance, we are told the former president looted the treasury, the former president did not just carry all the money from central bank without the connivance of the workers in the central bank. If you are told that a politician in a particular state has looted the treasury in that particular state, the politician did not just stand alone to loot everything in the treasury without the connivance of some persons who are workers. So the troubles we find ourselves in this country, we are all involved, whether the political class or the working class, whether in the private or in the public sector.
All right, Neville Obakedo, by way of extension, you're also a member of the Labour of the Workforce. How have you seen the NLC for this past 40, 41 years?
My point of assessing the performance of NLC is by, first of all, situating the Nigeria state in its own economic outlook and perspective. The Nigeria state is a capitalist state. And as a capitalist state, the managers of the state who constitute themselves into the ruling elite or governing elite, they are running the affairs of the state in their own interest and for the purpose of gaining at the end of the day. And so if Nigeria workers feel that in a capitalist state, whatever is due to them, they will get it, they are daydreaming. The reason is because they fail not to learn from the strength of the worker, from the history of China, how Mao Zedong led workers to cause the Chinese Revolution in 1949. And many years after, China has emerged from a poor country to one of the greatest countries of the world. I expect the Nigeria worker, including the union that I belong to learn from that history of the struggle of the Chinese worker. Now, I also expect the Nigeria Labour Congress and all the affiliate union, TUC, to learn from the Vladimir Ilyich Ulyanov Lenin's struggle against the Bolsheviks that led to what we call the Bolshevik Revolution in 1917 in the default USSR. I expect NLC, TUC, and other affiliate union to learn from Cuba, because some of them, under Fidel Castro, when they are campaigning, including my co-discussant who recently campaigned for chairmanship of NLC Edo State, they will be making reference to quotations like that of Fidel Castro, that there's no time in this world, there's no power in this world that can come against an idea whose time has come. They will say Fidel Castro. But the context between Fidel Castro made that statement, the kind of mobilization and the conscientization of the workforce that led to the revolution in Cuba that placed Fidel Castro on international limelight, they failed to do that. So what they are going to get in a capitalist system like ours is just peanut. That peanut can only come when they say they are going for minimum wage negotiation, they are going for better condition for workers. But with the energy, the strength, and the unity they have, they are afraid to deploy it, to let the exploiter to understand that we are not going to allow you to continue this your business as usual. I will give you an instance just now. I know that the only set of people that can liberate this country from whatever problem we are facing now is the workforce of Nigeria. Are they ready to do it? Is the question. A president can get as much as 7 billion, 10 billion for security in this country. And there will still be excessive insecurity in the land. What happened to that money? Workers are not asking questions. And that money is not money that you can be held accountable for. I leave the realm of the presidency. You go to all the states of the federation, all governors. I'm sure the least that a governor can get a security vote in Nigeria, I'm sure the least is 500 million. You see some governor getting 2 billion, 3 billion, 4 billion, 5 billion, depending on the power, the economic power of the state. You say security vote. And that vote, nobody is going to hold the governor accountable for the money. And there will still be insecurity, unprecedented insecurity in such states. And the workers are not, they are not excluded from the insecurity. Now, well, because of the nature of the Nigerian state, the workers have tried, they have made their contribution. Nobody can reduce that contribution that they have made, starting from Paibodu, Hassan Sumonu, Adam Soshomole, and all of them that have led Pascal Bafia, all of them that have led in their own way, their own right, they have made their own positive contribution.
Okay.
But it is not enough to destabilize those who are responsible for the problem that the nation is facing, who are also responsible for the poverty and the misery that the worker is living in.
Okay. Now, Money Mike Modesty, I know you have some reactions to make concerning to some of the things he has raised, but I just want you to briefly enumerate what do you think has been the greatest achievement of the NLC in this past 40, 41 years, even as you try to react to some of the claims that he made.
No matter what we may think, whether objectively or subjectively, the Labour Congress has remained the only opposition party.
But not a political party.
That's why you are seeing my though not a political party, the peace, the semi-peace we tend to have, whether economically or otherwise, in this country today, is made possible by the collaborative, cooperative spirits of the labor movement.
What kind of peace are you talking about now?
Well, that's why I said the semi-peace. He mentioned capitalism. That is the practice in our country. Exploitative tendencies are still very much present, not only here, especially everywhere. We are only virtually a capitalist state. But to what extent has the capitalism benefited us? But from the democratic set, our people will say we are running a welfarist state. That is kind of a social, socially inclined administrative style for our people. But in the reasons of it, it's capitalism. You provide your own water, you pay for bills in the clinic, electricity you don't get, you have to provide your electricity by yourself. Virtually everything you do by yourself. The social amenities that ought to be provided for you, you don't have access to any of them. So if I want to infer from what my brother has said, my brother comrade has said, I do not need to say that organized labor needs to carry arms and ammunition to start fighting government. Historically, from where we are coming from where we have gotten to, were it not for labor, I am sure that Nigeria would have since been on its knees. Economically, diplomatically, just mention it.
Yeah, Money Mike, if I gather from what you said, I think the question that we readily ask when we look at labor, pari passu, the ongoing tendency of the government, just like what he said, tendency to be capitalist in nature. Now, What do you think, what is the effect, you know, of this labor unionism, labor movement over time, you know, over what he has said?
That's government itself is not the capitalist. The government is aiding and abetting capitalism. So the labor movement has never been subjected to anything that has to agree with government trying to put capitalism, complete capitalism, on Nigerians. That is not to say that the traces of capitalism are not good. A marriage of capitalism and socialism gives a better governance system. But the one that's supposed to provide socialism is aiding and abetting capitalism. Let me even tell you, the privatization programs of PACN, NITEL, and all that, labor was involved because government wasn't able to run any of these enterprises, despite the billions of dollars they would pump into them. The thinking spirit then was, maybe if we try it the other way, it may be better for all of us. Mm-hmm. But that has been proven too wrong. So in any sphere that you may think of, as far as Nigeria is concerned, the labor movement is present. But the sincerity of purpose of those political leaders remains a big question mark.
So in this past 40, 41 years, what will you say has been the greatest, or is the greatest achievement of NLC?
Helping to liberate our people in most critical conditions. Helping to liberate Nigerians in most critical conditions. You know one thing about the labor movement? Everybody believes that it is the labor movement that will do the fight. Martin Luther King wasn't a labor leader. The trouble that started in Tunisia wasn't instigated by a labor leader. The recent protest that erupted that led the Nigerian Air Force to Zamfara wasn't started by a labor leader. But every Nigerian believes it's the labor leader, it's the labor movement. No. The Occupy Nigeria thing that happened during the time of Goodluck Jonathan was a collaborative thing between the labor movement, private and civil society groups.
Yeah, but the labor movement is probably a big umbrella that encompasses.
The labor movement is probably a big
umbrella.
Let me also tell you, we are practicing democracy right now. The people who are occupying these positions, are they from the skies? Are they not our own brothers and sisters? The people operating the labor movement, are they not in one way or the other also related by blood relationship or by kith and kins to these same people? The people operating government today, were they not at the time members of the labor movement, either as leaders or as followers in the labor movement? So when you look at it, who is the worker? Anybody who earns a wage, he's a worker. Even the governor of his state, technically speaking, is a worker.
And it's part of the labor movement.
And it's part of the labor movement. Technically speaking, it's also part of the labor movement. So when you want to really do a surgical analysis of who the worker is, you discover that those we hire through the electoral box are also members of the working class. But we group them separately because by the labor laws, they are not so recognized. So the labor movement, let me tell you, governments, most governments, are not even employing. Contract employment is what they are doing, casualization. They will tell you they don't have the resources to have permanent employment. And the unemployment market is so overbloated now. Okay, let's take the federal government's,
Empower Initiative.
Graduates are recruited into the scheme. After a period, they have no place to go. How do you now imagine such persons wanting to be committed to the scheme they have been admitted into? Because they know after 2 years or thereabout, it will no longer be there for them.
Yeah, the question that we also asked.
Labor has always agitated against casualization. But by the time the National Assembly makes a law that seems to give, to say instead of not employing at all, let's have people engaged through a social program, so to speak, then you also bound to also look backwards to say, instead of nothing, let there be something. Fundamentally, any positive revolution that happens in any country is not supposed to be a thing from the labor cycle? Is this supposed to be? When our politicians, so to speak, loot billions, who go to defend them when they know the truth? Are we not the same Nigerians? So when people do medical tourism, they leave our country for abroad. Those who are supposed to repair our country, they go abroad. And when Nigerians cry, who answers? Nobody. We are told recently that there is massive departure of our doctors to foreign lands. And the Minister of Labor says it is a good omen. Is it really a good omen? So it will take all of us to face the challenge, not just the labor movement. Not just the labor movement.
Okay, now, Neville Obakedo, during the military era, we saw twice that the labor, leadership was, imposed upon in the sense that we had two occasions that we had administrators. It happened during the time of Abacha. It also happened during the time of Babangida. Now, we are in a democratic rule. And some of the issues that we saw then, we are still seeing them now. So what do you think has been this problem all these years?
You see, the greatest problem of Nigeria the workforce or the Nigeria labor movement is the failure and inability of the movement to learn from history. Like I made reference to certain countries just now. And the list is longer than that. If you talk about Abacha, General Abacha's administration imposing leadership of LDC on people, you talk of General Babangida doing the same thing. It is because of their realization of the potency and the power of labor. They infiltrated into the labor movement to weaken them by appointing administrators for them. Now, the failure of the labor movement to learn from history that I made reference to. A labor movement, apart from the executive arm of the movement, which is the leadership, they're supposed to have what we call the intellectual wing of the movement. People who embed themselves in research, gathering information, statistics of, for example, the number of unemployed as at 2018, in 2019, these are the number of people that have entered that, and provide that statistics to NBS, that is National Bureau of Statistics, so that when labor want to make statements, like on May Day, they will make statements with concrete data and statistics that will send danger to the spine of those in government. That intellectual wing, if it's in existence at all, is weak. And if it's not in existence, it is a problem that the Nigeria labor movement need to solve. Number two, the Nigeria labor movement supposed to have what you call a militant wing. When I say militant wing, it's not a wing that you can compare with the military wing of African National Congress. They refer to as MK, but in Swahili, is called Ukoto Wesizwe. They don't need to take up arms, but when it comes to militancy, in terms of opposing those that are responsible for the crisis that workers and the country face, they should put up the militancy. That is missing. And if they want to make headway, they need to revive. If they have it, if they don't have it, they need to establish what we call a militant wing. Now, we talk about legal wing of the labor force. A legal wing of the labor force should not go to newspaper stand and say the president has traveled abroad now, the governor has traveled abroad now for military tourism. Is there any law that backs the president from traveling abroad to seek medical attention? If such a law does not exist, labor should put a machinery in place to stop the president from traveling outside the country for medical attention. He should go to National Hospital. Because if you look at the budget, we see that the president has been budgeting money for National Hospital and other health facilities in Nigeria. He should make use of them. Now, I'm aware that there is a law that have to do with remuneration and care for past president and their household. For example, a city president that is not well, if his condition is so critical to be taken outside Nigeria, he should be taken to the international airport. And when he gets to the international airport, the next available plane should take him to where he's going to get a treatment abroad at the expense of Nigeria. That law is in existence. So if labor people want to discuss medical tourism in relation to those in government, they should first of all go and purchase that law.
Yeah, but the labor movement is not the National Assembly, so...
Wait now, when you say National Assembly, when you say National Assembly, when you say House of Assembly, when you say House of Assembly...
We're talking about Constitution, we're talking about laws here.
Yes, so. Yes. If you listen to what my contribution on this subject matter, I said a legal wing that have to look at a president traveling outside Nigeria to go and seek a treatment abroad. Mm. And I said the legal wing of the labor movement should check whether such a law exists. If such a law exists, you call for an annulment of that law.
Such law,
yes. An amendment to that law that will now make president and governors and powerful persons in Nigeria to seek help in Nigeria.
Because according to what
in the case of the president, there is a law that empowers the president, himself, the wife, the children, biological children, is made to take the next available plane outside Nigeria for treatment.
Yeah.
That law is in existence. Mm. Is labor aware that such a law is in existence? Are they taking a step to make sure that law is amended so that the president cannot just be jockeying around the world?
Are you saying that there's anything wrong with that law?
Whether there's anything wrong with the law?
Yes, are you saying so?
I've not said anything wrong with the law. If it's a subject matter for discourse by labor, because my co-discourse I made reference to people who are supposed to be there was a way he called it just now and I knew it was referring to
Mr. President. He has not said anything wrong with such law, so I'm just trying to react to what you said.
He did not say anything was wrong with the law, but the way and manner he presented it is there's an order current that something is wrong with that law, and if I agree with him that something is wrong with the law, it don't need to be amended. And the amendment of the law is an assignment for the legal wing of the labor movement. You get what I'm saying? Now when we talk about labor movement, not under military government, labor movement in the civilian dispensation or democratic dispensation, the problem that labor has faced within the labor movement itself is we started by saying that Nigeria is a capitalist state, so we can be talking of the proletariat and the bourgeoisie in this realm. And now the labor has been bourgeoisified. Labor leaders have been bourgeoisified. If you see the houses that labor leaders live, the houses that they build, outside of their salary, if you see the vehicles that they ride, outside of their salary, and it is as a result of their being maybe leaders of labor union that behind the scene, they will give them contract. Behind the scene, they will give them ticket to travel outside the country. Behind the scene, they want a dime with the common enemy of the worker.
All these are allegations that
you see, because this is a television program and everyone is watching, and there are certain information that we can give here, because the persons we are giving the information about, they are not physically present. We are not in on the horse seat with them.
Anyway, let me pause you so that we can allow Money Mike Modesty to come in. Now, Money Mike, I know you have a lot of reactions to most of the things he said, but let me also quickly just ask you, even that he has said it, but one common thing that we readily see as some of the problems that seems to have been bedeviling the NLC for the past 40, 41 years is this polarization of the leadership of the NLC. I mean, just yesterday on our major news, we saw a factional leadership of Noge in those states. Even at the national level, there are two factions. You have the one led by Ayuba Wabba, and of course the other one led by Ajero and all that. Now, this has always been an issue. I mean, anytime we celebrate May Day, it's always come up. So how can we really put a stop to this so that the NSC can really move forward, so that the NSC can really engage, the government, just like what Mr. Neville is trying to say here?
In any human institution, you find things like this. The teeth and the tongue, they reside inside the same.
A polarized leadership?
Just hold on. Even in families, are you not aware that even a family that has been very solid. A time can come, such a family can be in parts.
But why do you think liberty allows their leadership to be infiltrated and polarized?
In any human institution, even in the spiritual realm, it also happens. If God decides that the story of the Tower of Babel, to say these guys were speaking the same tongue before, speaking the same language before, now that they are getting the initiative to be able to get it up to where I am, let me cause them confusion so that they go their separate ways. And it happened. That was on the spiritual realm.
I want us to be more sincere.
Yes,
because what we are doing here today is to probably find some lasting solutions to some of the issues.
Ask a question.
Yeah.
That's what I'm telling you. I am coming from somewhere.
Okay.
And I'm taking you somewhere.
Okay.
I have told you about the family. And I'm also telling you, in any human institution, whether former or informal, you find things of this nature. As our faces are different, likewise, our behavioral patterns. You may be an objective-minded person. My comrade brother may be a subjective-minded person. I might just be an opaque person who don't even belong to any. And all of us are expected to cohabit in the same place. But if you take the grace of God for us three to be able to manage ourselves, to throw away some of the habits and accept some from ourselves and move ahead. We are talking about division. It is a thing that will always be there in any human institution. But how we resolve is another.
Perhaps this is peculiar to Nigerian Labour Congress.
Even political parties, don't you hear of new APC, new PDP, don't you hear them? They are everywhere. That's why any human institution, even the church, started with Catholicism. Today, how many do you have? Even the Pentecostal aspect of it was started from somewhere. But today, how many denominations of the Pentecostal arm do you have? Judaism. I said any human institution. Any human. So long as human beings are present, that division will continue.
Okay, but be
that as it may,
yeah.
I am not supportive of the polarization
okay.
of trade unions.
Okay.
All that I have said are not yet well supported. As we speak, there are a lot of factors responsible for this. Greed is one of them.
Of some of your members?
Yes, members and leaders. The second is external factors. If we know this guy can do this, but if we allow him, we may not be able to get it the way we want to get it. And the people make themselves very vulnerable.
Do they ever know that these tendencies are capable of ruining most of their objectives?
Is it only the NSC? All the institutions that are always having this divide and rule system, this polarization, you think they don't know? But because of selfishness, greed, they allow their personal sentimentalities to take over everything. And at the long run, everybody suffers it. But to them, they don't care any hood, provided that their greed for power is achieved. But the implications negatively that now affect everybody is none of their business. That is when you now see what happens to the followership. The followership is supposed to be so organized to resist. But in Nigeria, do followers really resist?
All right, viewers out there, the program is still this morning on ITV. Happy Workers' Day one more time. And we're really having a great time here, you know, trying to just justice to some of the issues in labor force in Nigeria. And with us this morning, Money Mike Modesty, former secretary of the NLC Edo State and former treasurer of NLC Edo State and a labor devotee. Neville Obakede is also here with us, and human rights public affairs analyst, you know, trying to answer some of the issues, some of the questions that we're raising. Now, Neville Obakede, we are trying to talk about the tendency of the NLC being polarized. I mean, it's something that has becoming often and often. Yesterday on our major news, we watched a factional leadership of Nogi NOGA is an affiliate body of the NLC. Now, the question is, how can NLC go this far with all these kind of tendencies?
NLC or labor movement cannot go far when during their campaigns for elected positions in their union, they move from one office to another, a government house, or in other places, seeking support, seeking for either the governor, the secretary to government, the chief of staff, the head of service, to say this is government candidate. If that continues, they will not be able to make any headway.
Now, is it really possible for government to have influence in the elections? Because we need to know, because it is an election, Money Mike Modesty, it is an election. So how come it's possible for governments, like some of the allegations that we hear around, that governments pick up a candidate and sponsor such a candidate, and of course that candidate becomes a chairman of the NSC, a leader of the NSC? Why is it possible? Just let him hold on, I'll come to you. Nephew.
Yeah, the way I manage it is possible is this. There are people who operate from behind the scene. They will not contest for elected position, but they know when the tenure of the current ESCO will end. They know the body to pray. They know who to go and meet the government to say, election is coming, we better get a candidate now so that the candidate will not say there will be industrial action, they will not be organizing strike against the government. This is the person that we trust. So they will be taking that person or the persons to go and meet those in government to say, bring money, let us sponsor, let us go to social place, let's go to social place to go and mobilize people so that this person will be the candidate. They do it, and I'm aware that they do it. So in that process, from the beginning, the foundation for a better and qualitative leadership is not laid by the union, because at the end of the day, you'll be hearing the followers, they'll be saying, they said this man is the government candidate, they say this man is the government candidate, it's better I support him so that they will not go and give me query, or they will not go and fire me from my job. Before you know what's happening, that candidate emerges. If he emerges, then you expect that he's going to be following hook, line, and sinker any decision of government. And even if government refuses to pay minimum wage, government refuses to give normal what is due to workers, to the workers, the leadership under such a person will not rise to the occasion of saying, this is what our union persons deserve. You must give it, because through the back door, there is an arrangement. And that was why just now I made reference to the issue of contract, buying of luxury cars, even giving money, giving landed property and so on to such people, so that they will be dancing to the whims and caprices of those in government. If labor continues like that, whether the leadership or the followers, if they allow government to continue to determine who should be their leader, such labor movement, whether in Nigeria or elsewhere, whether in Edo State or elsewhere, they cannot make headway, because they will not have the temerity to challenge government on any issue that affect the state or that affect the country or on any issue that affect the workers, because you cannot eat your cake and have it. And you cannot go and whine with the devil in the night and come and be pretending to be an angel in the daytime. Mm-hmm. That is the way some of us that have critical mind see this subject matter.
Okay, now, Etua.
Well, I think I want to say that the system we operate in unions has to do with delegate system. For instance, a particular trade union, once they want to do their election, they have their constitution that dictates how the election should be done.
Mm.
Let me also quickly also mention that no labor union or trade center operates in isolation. 99% of those who are in government, when you say government, are workers. They are workers.
Mm.
Those contesting have brothers and sisters in the political echelon. So there is no law that will forbid them from reaching out to their brothers and sisters who are present in the political echelon. The degree of interference is what I will want to question. Somebody who is a delegate, you know who can do this job for you. It is secret balloting. And you are convinced in your mind that this is the guy that can do this job for me.
Mm.
What concerns you with whether somebody is coming from abroad or nowhere? You go there and do your oath and put your ballot paper there and move away. But you see one thing about Nigerians, even we that are the so-called educated too, even we that are so-called educated too, primordial sentiments, ethnic lineages, and many other factors come to play, even without government interference. So there are many things in labor politics or trade union politics that you even see. In some cases, it could even be more terrible than the public politics. Ah, we know he can do it. I know, but we'll allow him go. We'll allow him go. There will be internal and external forces.
Now, what is the NSC?
So, I told you, these are human institutions. These are human institutions. I don't know when we will grow as a people and as a movement. You know, when you have contests, for instance, you are talking about the Nogue issue now. Why would they, as a family, not be able to resolve themselves? It is possible. Two tents existed. And a lot of squabbles may have taken place before now. But even as it has happened yesterday, they are still members of the same family. That is what we call intra-union conflicts. The leadership of Nogue now has to go into the matter and resolve amicably.
Which leadership are we talking about?
The national leadership. And the national leadership can also do it alone. Let me tell you, no union lives in isolation. Is comprehensively independent of itself.
Of its own.
That's what we call critical stakeholders. Even government is a stakeholder. The working people, the artisans, as non-governmental organizations, civil society groups, they are stakeholders in the business of trade unionism. We have veterans, like the Nogue case sister. Nothing stops them from bringing all the veterans in a group together to say we are in a fix. Veterans, we want to leave this matter to you people. Come and help us resolve. I am telling you, it's still resolvable. But when you want to pretend not to know that there are people who can resolve the issue, you are holding your side, I'm holding my side, it will continue like that. Then the dividends that need to come to the members of Nogue may not come as expected.
Mm-hmm.
It may also come depending on who is overseeing their affairs.
Mm.
But it will be akin to saying that there is no Nogue government, in quotes, in Edo State, because they are into fashions. You recall the history of Ayuba and Ajero.
Yeah.
What was it? I must tell you, it was a matter of ethnic cleavages. I was a delegate at that conference. Omalamoma, my president of the Nigerian Union of Teachers, was doing his 8th year to be out of office. Comrade Adams Oshomole from the south did 8 years and handed over to Malamoma from the north, who was going out for 8 years. And ordinarily, with common sense, as people who preach against seat-tight government that has to do with a particular region, one would have expected to say, okay, no matter what, yes, Ayuba is a sound material. He's a very nice and sound material. One would have always said, the veterans and the elders would have come to say, okay, yes, why not let us see how we do it this way? Now let it go the other way. Or let us even put a template on ground. Every 4 years, let's be rotating these things. But because of numerical powers by the delegation and others, the thing went back to the north, where Ayuba is from. Ayuba is running a second term now, which means Ayuba is running 8 years.
Yeah.
And by extension, the north will be running 16 years. Are you following?
Yeah.
That it was just that ethnic coloration that caused Ajero's case. But for me, I would have expected Ajero, when that thing happened, to have said, well, I didn't come into this business as a do or die affair.
Yeah.
Now that it has come like this, there is no need shifting my goalposts from this place. Let's just remember, before you know it, will be over. I'm a critical example of what has just happened recently. Have you ever seen me talking everywhere?
Yeah, but some will say you probably don't have the kind of support that Nigeria has.
No.
Don't you think
Evans,
so, Mike Modesty?
I really didn't need to bring this matter up here.
Yeah, but we're discussing.
You
it's know, a conversation, yeah.
Is this Ayuba's and Ajado's case that is bringing this issue?
But if you had won the election, Money Mike Modesty, yes. If you had won the election, you would have probably also praised the effort that brought you into power. Don't you think so?
Let me tell you one thing. There is never a time you win an election without being appreciative of all those people that may have rallied behind you. When you say win an election, you have to be appreciative. And the appreciation is the one you say that day. And the work, good work, you work thereafter. It is only the good work you work thereafter that is the highest appreciation you can give to all those who supported you. You get what I'm saying? So, like my case happened, in fact, as I speak with you, it's a national matter. But I just told myself, I didn't come into this contest as a do or die, despite the fact that there's a very major technical flaw.
Yeah, now, but you also cannot say so, because that's your own opinion. I mean, the other person may be explaining it from the other side. So,
I am talking now as a derivative from the Ayuba and Ajero's case.
Yeah.
You get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I don't even want to dwell more on this because to me it's not even an issue.
It's not an issue. All right.
I have since moved on. You get what I'm saying?
And of course, you have pledged your loyalty to.
No. You see one thing about me as a person.
Yeah.
I was the candidate. The Nigeria Union of Teachers was the party. You get what I'm saying? And I have also been able to talk with my union to say, no big deal
about
this.
Let it be.
Why can't we just let's relax?
I like your spirit of sportsmanship.
Yes, you don't decide to pick it up to say no. That's a fundamental flaw here. We must challenge.
Let us not dwell so much on that.
What I'm telling you is that the polarization is the issue we are looking at.
All right, now
so the factors will always be there.
Okay, now let's go to Bayelsa State, because something it's developing in Bayelsa State that is related to labor issues. Now there are 24 men lawmakers in Bayelsa State recently proposed a bill. And, as a matter of fact, they passed it at the House level and forwarded that bill to Governor Dickson Sirikye for accents. Governor vetoed that bill, that, look, he cannot accent to this bill. Now, that bill, if at the end of the day the governor had accented to that bill, it would have meant that there would be a kind of a pension for life for all politically elected members of the House. Now, for some people, the best explanation to this is that if the governor is entitled to life pension, then why can't a member of the House of Assembly in Bayelsa State be also be entitled to life pension? Neville Obakedo.
Before I just talk about the life pension issue, let me just say that the Nigeria Labour Congress, whether in the case of Ayuba, Waba, and Ajero, they should go and take a leave, borrow a leave from NUJ. That rotate the presidency of their union between North and South. They should go and borrow a leave from Nigeria Bar Association that rotate their presidency between North and South, so that what happened between Ayuba and Ajero will not continue to happen.
To trickle
because
down.
Because democracy, whether democracy that have to do with union or democracy that have to do with the politics of a nation state, it's the democracy that have to do with number. And so if a particular section of the country, they just feel that because we have a more numerical threat, and this is not critically enshrined because in our constitution, we can throw up a candidate because of a numerical strength, we are likely to win. This crisis will continue to happen. But let me come to the issue of a life pension for those who occupy leadership positions. In a capitalist society like ours, we have elite. We have the ruling elite or the governing elite. Because they want to be relevant and they want to continue to rape the sick lady until she dies, they will put machinery in place to ensure that they continue to benefit from the system even when they are no longer at the helm of affairs. You are talking of Bayelsa State. Let me talk about Nigeria before I come to the issue of Bayelsa State. There is a law of the National Assembly that a former president of this country is entitled to life pension. If he dies, the wife will be entitled to life pension on his behalf. Then, if the wife dies, the children will be entitled to life pension on their father's behalf. Until the last biological child of the former president dies, the family will be entitled to life pension. Now, they will be changing their vehicles if they are not well, part of that law, is that if they are not well, even after leaving office, the next available jet can take them to the nearest hospital, whether it is in Dubai or any other part of the country. They have not amended that law. The law is still there. In our own state here, there is a law. The law has been existed from maybe around 1999 or so. But the immediate past governor amended that law. And the law was already passed by those three House of Assembly to increase the remuneration for past governor and the deputy. This is a conspiratorial criminal offense, in quote, against the people. And it is the elite that is doing it. The elite now in the executive, they present such a bill to the legislature in the case of Edo State I made mention of just now, and the legislature hurriedly passes it, maybe because of one benefit or the other, and then every month, a particular amount of money leaves the office, leaves the account of the state to former governors. And you know, if you are a governor, outside of your salary, the money that your hand will touch, both legal and illegal, is enough to free your generation from poverty.
Yeah, and every less situated.
Yes, I'm coming to the issue of Bayelsa State. Yeah. Yes, I say I have to give other example because Bayelsa State is a subsystem in Nigeria. Just like Edo State is a subsystem. Just like a federal government is part of the system of Nigeria. So we cannot just say Bayelsa, see Bayelsa is an isolated case.
The issue of Bayelsa, let's talk.
I salute the courage of the governor to have refused to accept to that bill.
On what basis are you doing that? I mean, if the governor is elected, don't you think other House members are also elected too?
Yes, because he is going to, like, he's setting a dangerous precedent. Do you know the number of House of Assembly members that Bayelsa will continue to produce from now till this world will end? So then every House of Assembly member that comes and goes will be entitled to that money.
No, those House members, are they elected?
Yeah, they are elected.
What about any governor that will come to Bayelsa State? Yeah, if you not elected.
Yeah, my brother, advance. Yeah,
I'm not trying to speak
for them. Listen to my contribution just now. Mm. I started from the presidency.
Yeah.
And I say, making such a law for a president, vice president, all those top functionaries of government who are elected, who have access to all the resources of the state for the number of years they are going to be there, for them to be placed on life pension. I say it's criminal.
Okay, so
even though there's a law like that, that's why when we talk about civil society, we talk about labor union.
Yeah, and so what you are saying is that law should be
the law, whether it as it applied to federal to the federal government, as it applied to all the states of the federation, including Edo State and Bayelsa State, whether for governor, whether for House of Assembly member,
it should be amended.
They should.
All right,
obliterate that law.
Yeah, Money Mike, let's hear from you.
Yes, let me also inform you that there's what we call severance package for elected public servants. If you're a councillor, once you are serving out, there's an amount you're supposed to pick away. That severance package is supposed to serve as bye-bye gift to stabilize you from the vicissitudes of expenditures that may need to be coming around you while you're no longer in the office. I think that is applicable to the members of the House of Assembly. Yesterday, the National Assembly appropriated billions for their own severance allowance. And it's backed up by law. It's not just an appropriation that is not backed up by law. President taking a pension,
pension for life,
The question you ask yourself is, if Dixon of Bayelsa
can take,
having now serving his second tenure out, who made the law? The House of Assembly. They made the law that gave him that entitlement for himself and his deputy. So the House of Assembly, you also know, you can come into the House over and over again, as many times as your people choose you to come, you can always be there. But there's a limitation to the number of times you can stay in the office as a governor. For me, generally speaking, I don't even see that as even necessary. The gratuity or pension of it, it's not even necessary. Okay, most of our former presidents, they were former heads of state. You get what I'm saying? So I will now say, what they earn as retired military general will no longer be available for them, or those ones are now written off on the altar of the new
pension.
So a lot of issues are involved. But this matter has been debated over and over again. But it has since come to stay. For the Bayelsa House of Assembly to be asking that the House members will also be getting life pension. I think they went too far. If Governor Dixon decided to refuse assent, I would also tell him thank you. But it would have been better if Governor Dixon would have, in his own wisdom, cancelled the one that he's presently taking.
He has not even started taking. So only when he listens.
It's not done. It's still there.
I would have lost it when he would have said, maybe because people appropriated for me the law to do that. That's why you are contemplating this. As it stands, I'm sending an executive bill to amend that old law, not excluding me from such a.
Okay, gentlemen, as we wrap up now, let's go back to the day, the celebration of the Labour Day and all that. So what do we really expect from the government? Let me start from Money Mike.
Well, generally speaking, the 30,000 peanut minimum wage is
I thought you were going to say that your greatest achievement is the 30,000 minimum wage.
30,000, as far as I'm concerned, it's not even an achievement.
But at least it's the highest of it all
as
now.
As far as I, Money Mike, no less the eat twice concerned. It's not an achievement because that 30,000 has since gone. And if some people go to 30,000, by the time you remove pay as you earn, it goes down. But even at that, we are seeing something going to be added, so to speak. Emotionally, I don't see it as an achievement for us. Mm. Emotionally, I don't see it.
But I think it's a good one. We heard that the National Assembly just approved some amounts.
A proposal of 20% increase in VAT is before us. When the voice of Jacob and
it's only a proposal. The federal government has said that there is no such intention.
Rwanda committee recommended it.
Yeah.
And I'm happy that Bola Tinubu even advised during his last colloquium that federal government should not even contemplate it. But on the other hand, the voice of Jacob, the hands of Esau, through IMF, is also saying remove.
All these are suggestions.
You know that since the time the agitation for new wage started, for increase in wage started, prices started skyrocketing. Even as at the time the president had signed, it has jumped again.
I think the federal government is looking into that.
The Labour just deliberately decided to accept.
What do you think the Labour, what do they really want from the government? Quickly.
What we want from the government is this. Free. Let's have access to housing. Let's have access to free medical facilities in our clinics. Let's have access to pipeline water. Let's have access to rail system that works. Let's have access to power supply that works 24/7. And if we have access to any of this, to all this, and you are telling us minimum wage is 2,000 naira, we will gladly accept it. We will gladly accept minimum wage of 2,000 naira.
Okay. Now, Neville Obakedo, quickly.
You see that if the Nigeria labor movement remains divided, they will not be able to achieve anything. Because, like the theme of this year's May Day celebration, unify workers for social and economic development. Now, if the workers are not united, how can they follow, how can they even discover the road to social development, not to talk of following the road? If the workers are not united, how can they even discover the road to economic development, not to talk of following that road? Now, the workers need to bury their primordial sentiment and create what we call a class consciousness. This is an exploited class. We need to bury our ethnic orientation. We need to bury our ethnic affiliation and ensure that in this Nigeria state or in this Edo state, we be united to make sure that we enjoy the prosperity of this state or of this country. If that is missing, the Nigeria labor movement will only be getting peanuts from those in government, whether at federal level, state level, or local level.
Okay.
And I say they should go and learn from other places and put machineries in place to have what we call intellectual wing outside of their leadership, to have what I refer to as legal wing, and to have what I refer to as military wing.
Okay. All right. Thank you so much, gentlemen. Nevio Bakedo, thank you so much.
Thank you for having me. Happy Workers' Day to my fellow workers.
And Happy Workers' Day. So just like what these two gentlemen said, that the Nigerian labor has a lot to learn. Most especially this idea of factionalization is really not going to get the NLC to anywhere because a divided house can really not stand, and you know, a divided house also cannot achieve much. So as we celebrate the Nigerian worker out there, please celebrate yourself as a worker, and do make sure that you abide with the law of the land. Thank you so much, gentlemen, one more time. So we'll take a short pause now for other segments. Please stay tuned.